no food, no siree. I want to live to be 90.
Hey guys, Carl's out there crack filling by himself. I need you to get out there ASAP and make sure he's doing it right. And if he doesn't listen to you this time, I need you to tell him I'm going to come out there myself and whip him into shape. Got it? Bye. Oh, I have had it with Carl. If he wants to continue to work here at ODOT, he has got to learn how to do things right. I just got to get out there by myself and just try to whip him back into shape.
I'm no fool, no siree. I'm gonna live to 103, huh?
You do it.
What do you think I'm doing? I'm filling a crack.
That's not a crack. Crack. Size of pencil.
Huh.
What are you doing out here, folks? Please. No gloves.
Where's your glasses?
I'm filling. I'm filling a crack! I know what I'm doing!
Not for ODOT, you're not.
Carl, did you forget to do a pre-trip inspection?
Well, blow my goose! Someone forgot to put oil in the dang thing!
That someone would be you, Carl.
Hey, it's not my fault! I didn't use it last!
You've got some learning to do. I know some guys in Fayette County will set you straight. But before we go, I'm going to give you a refresher course on crack filling.
9 o'clock.
Carl, what are you doing? Those aren't the right answers for that. I mean, you just don't understand this. I can see this already. Sit down in that chair right there, and I'm going to tell you all about crack filling, because this is just not getting anywhere. Now remember, Carl, you have to be safety smart to start off with. That means you're wearing the right protective equipment and doing it.
Yeah, you and your safety smarts.
Listen, Carl, crack filling can be very dangerous, especially when you're using unique equipment that gets very hot. There are cars speeding by and other people you need to be aware of to do a safe and productive crack filling job. Too much can go wrong if you don't pay attention and work as a team. That's why it's important to understand the how, what, why, and when of crack filling.
Wow, I guess I got a lot to learn. No wise one of crack filling.
Don't be a wise crack filler. Crack filling is a preventive maintenance tool which helps extend the life of the pavement anywhere from 1 to 3 years. Cracks in the pavement surface allow water and other uncompressible materials such as sand, dirt, and debris to enter the pavement structure. The presence of cracks can dramatically accelerate deterioration and weakening of the pavement. This is especially important given the current transportation funding environment and focus on being more efficient and effective in our operations. Selecting the proper pavements for crack filling is critical to ensure the preservation and extension of life of pavement. Since crack filling is a preventive maintenance technique that has no structural capacity to pavement, ideal pavement candidates for this technique exhibit minor pavement distress and have sufficient structural capacity to meet present and future structural needs. Pavements with transverse and longitudinal cracks are good candidates for crack filling.
Oh, man, my brain hurts. What's all this talk about transportation funding, pavement presentation, I can't spell longitudinal.
It's longitudinal cracks. These type of cracks means there are no structural issues with the pavement.
Why do I need to know this?
Carl, as an HT, you are on the front lines every day making sure our roads and bridges are safe. Ohio drivers depend on you to do the right thing. So that's why it is important to know the why and how to do your job.
I know what you mean. You know, my girlfriend, she always wonders why I go fishing and don't take her. I think I'm getting it now.
And if for some reason you don't get it, the Office of Training has a great manual which can be found on the Office of Training's website. Now usually the best time of the year to crack fill is in the fall and early spring when the cracks are most open. Otherwise the asphalt material will not adhere or stick to the pavement. Okay, Carl, I think you learned quite a bit. Let's take time to recap here and find out what you really learned. I've got some questions on the board. I want you to provide those answers to each of those questions. So the first one is, what is filling and sealing?
Well, if I remember right, pavement. Preservation. How you spell that?
P-R-E-S-E-R-V-A-T-I-O-N.
Excellent. Pavement preservation. That good?
That's excellent. Okay, right. Next question is, why do we do it?
Well, extend, E-X-T-E-N-D, the life of pavement.
Good job, Carl. You weren't asleep the whole time. Glad to see you've woken up to realize what's going on here.
All right,
and the last question is then, when do we do it?
Well, the best time to do it the fall and the spring.
Excellent.
How's that?
All right, you remember everything we talked about. Now you have a real good understanding of what crack filling is, why do we do it, and when do we do it. But before we head down to Fayette County to show you how to fill cracks, it's important to talk safety.
All right, well, let's get her done.
Let's talk personal protective equipment. First, always wear long sleeves and pants. No cut-off sleeves, Carl. It's gonna be cold anyways. Second, leather gloves and boots. Third, safety vest and hard hat. And finally, a face shield.
I can barely move in this. I feel like a little brother in a Christmas story.
I can't put my arms out.
Well, put your arms down when you get to school.
Does your girlfriend know you're such a sissy?
No, she doesn't know I'm a sissy. Whoa, wait a second here. I'm not a sissy.
And we're moving on. Now remember, you need to have the right safety gear, which includes vest, hard hat, gloves, long sleeves and pants, boots and face shield. Now that you know the required PPE, we need to go over the other safety items which can save your life and the lives of the others on your crew. Don't worry, Carl. We won't go into too much detail. We'll leave that to the Fayette County crew. And remember, all this can be found where, Carl?
In the interweb?
No, it's not the interweb. It's the intranet on the Office of Training's website. The safety procedures to include in the crack filling operation are tailgate safety talk, traffic control, rotation of crew, first aid procedures, escape routes in emergencies, MSDS, and plenty of drinking water. You got all that, Carl?
Is it lunchtime yet? My belly's talking to me. I need some grub, and it ain't now.
You've got a lot to learn, Carl. Come on, it's time to visit the Fayette County crew and show you the proper way to get her done.
Okay.
They're trying to have a tailgate talk. Let's get back in the truck and go over to the crack filler and meet them there.
Morning, guys. We're going to have a tailgate talk before we get started on safe work practices for crack sealing. And some of the hazards are moving traffic, moving equipment, hot flammable materials, flying particles when blowing out the cracks, temperature extremes, overcrowding of workers, slip, trip, and fall conditions on the site.
Now, Carl, they're going to implement a proper pre-trip inspection, so pay attention and you'll learn how to properly check equipment and not blow up an engine.
Then we move on down to the engine compartment. We're going to start with the battery today. Make sure the connections are tight and not corroded, so we have a good starting.
After he finishes there, he's going to move on up to the coolant level and check the coolant level, make sure it's sufficient for the day. And as he starts to go back, he's going to check the dirt evacuator. And he's also going to check the air filter indicator while he's right there. Then he's going to kind of look down at the belts and the water pump. Make sure there's no leaks and the belts are tight. While he's right there, he's going to take a look at the alternator. And he's going to look around for any leaks at all and check all the hoses, make sure everything's good and tight. And while he's right there, he's going to check the exhaust system, make sure it's tight and good working order. And he's got a fire extinguisher, there's one on each side. He's going to check it, make sure it's tight and secure. We keep two on the machine. Then he's going to move on back towards the fuel cap, check the diesel fuel level for the day. Make sure everything's good shape there. He's going to look at the wheels, the rims, the tires. He's going to check the valve stems, the lug nuts, the wheel fasteners. And then he's going to give an overall view of the machine, make sure everything looks the way it's supposed to every morning. He's going to check the lights on it. He's going to check the tail lights, turn signals left and right. Go check the emergency flashers four ways, backup alarm, make sure it's working properly. He's going to look at all the reflectors, make sure they're all in the proper position and nice and clean, not have a lot of mud or dirt on them. Now on this side, Mike's going to check the pendle hitch, make sure it's securely mounted and everything's tight. He's going to check the safety chains, electrical plug-ins, make sure everything's secure to the truck. And then he's going to move to the safety equipment and make sure that we have at least two 5-gallon jugs of water on for in case someone would get burned, we could pour it on their burn. He's going to check the fire extinguishers. We've got two on the crack sealer, one in the truck, and we also have safety first aid kit in the truck at all times. And then he's going to check the oil on it, pull out the dipstick and get a good reading on it every single day. And after that, he's going to move on back and get the start hours off the machine. There's a gauge right there that says the start hours and the shutdown hours. We record that every day. And he's going to check for the hydraulic oil. Make sure the level's okay on it. Then he's going to move back up to the starting gauge, and he's going to turn the switch to the left for the preheat. Just takes a few seconds to preheat it, and then he's ready to fire the machine up. After that, he's going to go back to the control box and turn the burner on. Set the hot oil temperature at around 500 degrees, and then he's going to put the material temperature at around 370 to 380. And it'll take a little while for it to heat up to that range. When it does, then the hose temperature light indicator light will come on. And when it reaches around 275, 280, the agitator pump will kick on. It gets up around 380, then we're getting, and all the temperatures around 500 to 380. And the hose temperature 380, then we're ready to start our operation for the day. After he gets his temperature control set and his burner turned on, he's going to go right on back and make sure that the MSDS book is in its proper location. He's going to open the container, make sure it's in there. We do this on a daily basis. After this, he's ready to take his crew to the job site and start for the day.
All right, Carl, it's time to set the work zone. Let's take a drive and see how it's done. You see, Carl, they follow the OMUTCD for setting up proper work zones. Without a proper work zone, someone could get seriously injured or killed. There were more than 5,000 work zone crashes last year alone, with 10 being fatal.
I'm too pretty to get hurt, boss.
I'll let your girlfriend be the judge of that. Now put on your vest and let's get out there and watch them load the hopper and clean out the cracks.
As Mike prepares to get material ready for it to put into the crack filler, you'll notice as he's cutting the boxes away, he's cutting away from himself. He's getting the material open so that he can put into the crack seal. He's going to put the material on these hips, take the box, put it in the back of the truck so no debris blows into the roadway as we're doing this. Mike's opened the crack sealer lid. He's getting material block put on there. Notice as he's putting it in, he steps away as the material goes into the crack filling machine. As he prepares to put the second block in, notice his face shield he has on for protection so that if there is any hot splash, it won't go in his eyes. Watch as Gary cleans out the cracks, makes two even passes to ensure debris, dust, and moisture is removed. At this time, Stacy is going to actually fill the crack.
Wait a minute. That's it? All your safety stuff? Tailgate talks? Pre-trip inspections and blah, blah, blah? Just rub a little black glue in the ground?
Okay, Wisecrack. Let me show you why ODOT does it this way. This work is dangerous, and all it takes is a little mistake, and you can severely injure yourself or one of your crew members. During the work properly, we'll also keep workers off the road for follow-up repairs and help the pavement last longer, thus saving taxpayer dollars. I don't know about you, Carl, but at the end of the day, I want to go home proud and tired, knowing I did the right thing to extend the life of the pavement and keep myself and the crew and the motorists safe on the road. You need to check your equipment and follow all of the required steps to do a quality job safely. It's like going fishing. You gotta check your line, your reel, your bait, your boat, even before your first cast.
You know, boss, I got it now.
Thank heavens. Now you want a good even coat, no greater than 4 inches. Watch for bubbles and voids and monitor the temperature throughout the operation.
Hello, everyone. I hope you've enjoyed this best practice video. All joking aside, it is vital that we implement the proper ways to crack fill. That means taking the extra steps of keeping yourself and each other safe. So let's clean up and let's get out of here. And remember this, we want to get her done, and we want to get her done safe.